Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome, brothers and sisters, to another episode in the series Gardens of the Righteous. With myself is Sheikh Haitham Al Haddad, who is from the UK and is on the board of the Sharia Council of Britain and is also the founder of the website www.islam21c.com. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We are still now on the chapter of repentance, the chapter of Tawbah. Would you like me to continue with the next hadith?
Inshallah, yes. Hadith number 19. Hadith Zir ibn Hubaysh. Zir ibn Hubaysh, he said that he came to Safwan ibn Assal.
Zir ibn Hubaysh, radiallahu anhu, relates, I went to Safwan ibn Assal, radiallahu anhu, to inquire about the wiping out with the hands over the footwear in the course of ablutions. He asked me, Zir, what brings you here? I replied, acquisition of knowledge. He said, angels spread their wings out of pleasure for one who seeks knowledge at what he seeks. I told him that some doubt has arisen in my mind concerning the wiping out the hands over the footwear in the course of ablutions after one has been to the privy or the urinal. Now, you are one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I have come to ask you, did you hear him saying anything on this subject? He answered, yes. He directed us that while on a journey, we need not take off our footwear for washing the feet in the course of ablutions consecutively for 3 days and nights, except after consorting with your wives. In other cases, example, sleeping, answering the calls of nature, mere posing of the hands over the footwear or shoes should suffice during that period.
Yeah, okay. So just let me rephrase this. So Zir bin Hubaysh is one of the companions. He came to Safwan ibn Assal, again another companion. Zir came to Safwan ibn Assal to ask him about wiping over the footwear. And this shows that the companions used to go visit each other, inquire about knowledge and study. So Safwan said, Zir, why are you coming? He said, I came to inquire about wiping over the footwear. Why did he come to inquire about wiping over the footwear? Because after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam, some people questioned wiping over the footwear. And they said that is this from the sunnah or not from the sunnah? Because in the Quran, Allah jalla wa ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu idha qumtum min as-salati faghsilu wujuhakum وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ. So it is talking about what? Washing the feet. Yeah? And that's why they said Surah Al-Ma'idah, which includes this ayah, is one of the very last surah of the Quran that was revealed. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ. And there is another hadith, hadith Jarir ibn Abdullah al-Bujali. He narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wiped over his footwear. The companions used to like this hadith. Why? Because Jarir accepted Islam very late after what? The revelation of Surah Ma'idah. Yes? So they said that this means that wiping over the footwear abrogates the ghusl in certain circumstances, because he confirmed that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam used to wipe over his footwear, yeah, despite the ayah of Surah Ma'idah, which means that the ayah of Surah Ma'idah is still there, but in some circumstances where the person cannot wash his feet, then he can wipe over his footwear because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it.
Yeah? So it's a concession from the sunnah.
No. It is not a concession.
It's an option.
It is another option. That's why this scholar said that if you are barefoot, yeah, barefoot, then wash. The sunnah is to wash. If you are wearing something that meets the general requirements of khuf, yeah, and the main condition is that you wore this footwear after a wudu, after a complete ablution, and then you broke your wudu while you are wearing them, and now you want to make a new wudu. So make a new wudu, don't take the footwear off, yeah, if it covers your ankles and you already wore them after a complete tahara, no, wipe over them. This is the sunnah. So it is another option. It is not a concession. But it was legislated as what? To make life easy for us. To make Islam and wudu easy for us. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. In hadith, Al-Mughira, رضي الله تعالى عنه, said, I was helping, you know that Al-Mughira was serving the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he said, I was serving the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم and helping him in his wudu. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was doing wudu, then he wanted to wash his footwear. So I went down in order to take them off.
He wanted to wipe over his footwear.
Al-Mughira said, I wanted to take them off in order for the Prophet ﷺ to wash his feet. The Prophet ﷺ said, no, leave them, because I put them on after Tahara. So he will what?
Wipe.
Wipe over them. And that's why Imam Abu Hanifa said, I did not confirm that wiping over the footwear is from the Sunnah, except I have seen that it was reported by more than 70 of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why Ibn Taymiyyah as well considered believing in it as matter of what? Aqeedah. Not because this fiqh issue is a matter of aqeedah, no. He said because it has been reported by so many of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So denying it means that the person is denying what? The authentic ahadith. Yeah? So he is denying the authentic hadith, which is what some sects claim. Yeah? So they are mubtadi'ah and they don't believe in wiping over the footwear because they rejected the ahadith. Them so many ahadith that some of them even were reported in Bukhari and Muslim that talk about wiping over the khuf. Okay? So this is the explanation of this part. So Zir went to Safwan to inquire about this. Safwan said, Zir, why are you coming? He said, well, I came to ask about this issue. Then Safwan said, yes, we were commanded by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam that if we were in a journey, the translation said in a journey. Journey means safar, safar. Safar from one city to another remote city, far city. We were commanded that if we were in that journey, long journey, safar, that we can wipe over the footwear 3 consecutive days and their nights, 72 hours. Mm-hmm. Yeah? We can wipe over them. We don't need to take off the shoes or the footwear to wash our feet. Subhanallah, this is yani is very helpful, by the way. Very helpful in terms of safar. And imagine, don't think of us traveling by planes and yeah, life is comfortable. No. Islam came to help everyone, and in particular to help poor people who are facing difficult situations. So imagine those who are still traveling in Africa with no facilities and so on. Yeah? So the sunnah for them, okay, is to wipe over the footwear for 3 consecutive days if they want. Okay? Now, except if there is a full sexual relationship, which is the major impurity, major spiritual impurity, janaba. In that case, the person has to have what?
Ghusl.
Full ghusl. For the ghusl, the person what? Has to take off the footwear to make a ghusl. He cannot make ghusl and wipe over the footwear. But the hadith says, when can he wipe over the footwear if he broke his wudu out of what? Deep sleep, yeah? Or defecation or urine. Which are the 3 acts that break what? The wudu. Yeah? So this is about wiping over the footwear. Mm-hmm.
Brothers and sisters, please come back after the break. We shall continue to have a look at this amazing hadith. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
A light from Allah in the darkness. A guide from Allah in the confusion.
ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء.
A cure from Allah for every sickness.
وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يؤوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم.
The Quran. Join me, Muhammad Timhum, as we study the beautiful passages of the Quran and the great lessons that they contain in Lessons from the Quran.
Study about the glorious lessons that connect us to our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Lessons from the Quran. Tomorrow, at 11 p.m. and repeat telecast at 12 p.m. Saudi Arabia on Peace TV.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth, and who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch truth prevail and lies perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik, next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Welcome again, brothers and sisters, to the discussion of this chapter of repentance, or the chapter of Tawbah. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We are just in the middle of this hadith. Would you like me to continue?
Yes, yes, inshallah.
Zir ibn Hubaysh then asked Safwan ibn Assal, did you hear him say anything concerning love and affection, him being the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He replied, we were with the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the course of a journey, when a rustic Arab called out to him in a loud and rough tone, O Muhammad. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered him almost in the same tone, well, I am here. I said to the Arab, woe be to thee. Don't talk loudly in his presence, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thus has Allah directed us. Replying to me, he said, I will not soften my tone. And then addressing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, again he said, what about a man who loves the people but has not yet been admitted to the same? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered, on the day of judgment, a person will be in the company of those he loves. He then, resuming his talk with us, referred to a gateway somewhere in the west. Both the ends of the width of which could be covered by a rider in 40 or 70 years. Sufyan, who is one of the narrators of this hadith, adds, "This gateway is towards the direction of Syria. Allah has created this gateway along with the universe and the heavens. It is open for repentance and will not be closed till the sun rises from the west."
Subhanallah. Okay. So let us continue the hadith. We have mentioned that he asked him about wiping over the footwear, and then Zir ibn Habish told him that the Prophet ﷺ commanded us that if we are in a long journey, a safar, then we can wipe over the footwear for 3 consecutive days and 3 nights, except if we break our purity by sexual relationship. But if we break our purity with defecation or urine or sleeping, then we can wipe over the footwear and we don't need to take them off. Then Zer said, "Safwan, have you heard the Prophet ﷺ talking about love and affection?" And he said, "Yes, yes." There was one incident where we were traveling with the Prophet ﷺ, and a Bedouin, uneducated layman from the desert, a rough person. Normally, this is their qualities. Yeah, they are rough, coming from the desert. Obviously, they will not be soft, nice, as they say, civilized. So he came and he followed us, and then he said, "Ya Muhammad." Now this is rude. Yeah? He didn't say even "Ya Rasulullah." And this is their nature. But obviously later they were prohibited, or Muslims were prohibited from calling the Prophet ﷺ by his name. In general, this is a bit rude to call the Prophet ﷺ "Ya Muhammad." Yeah? Now, is this before Muslims were prohibited to call the Prophet ﷺ "Ya Muhammad" or after? This is not a big issue, because you know Muslims were prohibited in calling the Prophet ﷺ "Muhammad." Even now, we as Muslims, we cannot say "Muhammad said." Astaghfirullah al-Azim. لا تجعلوا دعاء الرسول بينكم كدعاء بعضكم بعضا. Don't call the Prophet as you call each other. Yeah? Don't do it. So we should say Muhammadur Rasulullah. Or we should say our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But this Bedouin said, "Muhammad, Muhammad." So Zir said, "Come on, what's wrong with you? Don't raise your voice, don't use this language." He said, no, I will use it. You know, Bedouin. Then the Prophet ﷺ, see, out of his gentleness, most of the rights of the Prophet ﷺ were revealed in the Quran. And then the Prophet ﷺ would explain them. Not the Prophet ﷺ said, "This is my right." Most of the rights of the Prophet ﷺ. For example, this. لا تجعلوا دعاء الرسول بينكم كدعاء بعضكم بعضا. Allah said this is the right of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Don't call him by his name as you call each other. Allah jalla wa ala said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or Allah jalla wa ala said concerning another right of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, النبي أولى بالمؤمنين من أنفسهم وأزواجه, his wives are أمهاتهم, are the mothers of the believers, and so on. Anyway, so Zir said to this Bedouin, "Come on, don't talk to the Prophet ﷺ like this." He said, no, I will continue. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Ha'um, here I am." So then that Bedouin, he said, "What do you say about a person who loves people, but he is not doing like them in terms of good deeds, or he has some shortcomings, or he could not join them in the dunya? What do you say about him?" He was indicating, will he be joining them in the Jannah? So the Prophet ﷺ said, subhanAllah, this is the gentleness of the Prophet ﷺ, said, "Al-mar'u ma'a man ahab." The person will join those whom he used to love in the dunya. Yeah? The Prophet ﷺ did not tell this specific Arabi that you will be with us. He gave a general rule. However, sometimes The Prophet ﷺ would say to certain people, you are like this. But in this hadith, no. The Prophet ﷺ made it general, that the person will what? Will follow those whom he what? Whom he used to love. Al-mar'u ma'a man ahab. Then he continued speaking about certain things. Then the Prophet ﷺ described a gate on the day of resurrection. That gate, in order to travel from one side of that gate to the other side, you need to ride a horse and run from one side to the other side for 40 years or 70 years. That gate is a gate of Tawbah. A gate of Tawbah. Imagine. Everyone will go through that gate. Repents will go through that gate, and his repentance will be accepted as far as the day of resurrection does not start. Okay? So the Prophet ﷺ said that there will be a gate before the day of resurrection. Sufyan, the narrator of this hadith, said that this gate will be next to Asham. Asham, Syria is not a wrong translation of Asham. Asham includes now Jordan, north part of Jordan, Palestine, Lebanon, and Syria. This is Asham, Asham area. So he said this gate is in that direction. And that gate, all people who will repent will go through that gate. Subhanallah. That gate will never be closed until what?
Until the
sun rises from the west. Now, what does that gate mean? That gate means that the Tawbah is open for everyone. The Tawbah is open for everyone. And it will not be closed until the day of resurrection, until the start of the day of resurrection. Obviously, we don't see that gate now. But it is either we say that it is a symbolic representation, or it is real, and most of the scholars, or the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah, they say that it is a real gate. Because when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam said that there is a gate, not a symbolic representation of a gate. There is a gate. We don't see it, but it is there. And Allah jalla wa ala allows people who repent to go through that. Subhanallah al-Azim. This is, again, for us, although we don't see the gate, but it is like visualizing again. It
creates a picture of how...
Creating a picture. So we can see it, we can feel it, we can live with it.
We have an idea of how big the gate of Tawbah is.
We can have an idea how big that gate is. So we can all flee and just go. And again, as you said, we can have an idea how big that is. We also can rush into it before it is locked up.
But we need to take the step.
We need to take the step, as we always say. Yeah? So this hadith is narrated by Imam Tirmidhi, and he said that it is an authentic hadith. Anyway, my dear brothers and sisters, we should continuously make tawbah, and no one should give up making tawbah, because Allah Jalla wa Ala took upon himself that he will continue accepting tawbah of people. Yeah? And one of the names of Allah Jalla wa Ala is what? At-Tawwab. Yeah? At-Tawwab means he forgives. This is one of the names of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Yeah? And Allah Jalla wa Ala, we all know that he is Al-Ghafoor, oft forgiving. Yeah? Al-Rahim. We did not mention the name of Allah Jalla wa Ala, that he is what? At-Tawwab. Yeah? At-Tawwab means the one who accepts the Tawbah. May Allah Jalla wa Ala accept the Tawbah from us.
Ameen.
And may Allah Jalla wa Ala enable us to make istighfar all the time.
Ameen.
And may Allah Jalla wa Ala as well accept the Tawbah of people and help people to what?
To make
tawbah. May Allah Jalla wa Ala help and give the ability to all people to do tawbah to him. Jazakallah khair.
Brothers and sisters, please come back to us when we shall continue the discussion in the next episode on the second chapter in Riyadh al-Salihin, which is the chapter of Tawbah, the chapter of repentance. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
He created the universe. To him belong the heavens and the earth. The ever-living, he is the first. He's the owner of mercy. He sent his messengers.